Recorded Books and RB Digital present Moving Forward Sideways Like a Crab by Shani Mootoo. Narrated by Graham Rowat and Kevin R. Free.
From Sydney's Notebook. Surely it is a failure of our human design that it takes not an hour, not a day, but much, much longer to relay what flashes through the mind with the speed of a hummingbird's wing. There is so little time left now, and what Jonathan wants to know and I to say are not the same. I realize Jonathan is a grown man and can surely take whatever words I offer him, but what good would come of it if I were to tell him how, 10 years into my relationship with his mother, India, she informed me that I was a disappointment? I would not want to encourage him to consider this, lest in doing so he concur. Nor does he need to know that there was a time after his mother and I first met, in those months before he was born, when India would ask after our lovemaking, "How did you know to do that?" Does he need to know that she gripped my shoulders and trembled? Or should he know? I wonder if he would believe it. He certainly doesn't need to know that after his birth, India and I grew cool with each other. And yet, nearly 10 years later, when we broke apart, I hadn't stopped loving her. Should he know that? He would likely scoff at this pathetic admission. It might even appall him. After India and I first met, in the months before I moved into our house, I saw my physical upkeep as part of a daily drama between her and me, and I made a job of keeping my body trim and groomed. My clothing and sheets washed and pressed, my shoes polished, my kitchen and bathroom clean and tidy, wine in the fridge and chocolate on my bedside table. 10 years later, the list of what it turned out I was inept at doing included putting up shelving in her office, organizing and cleaning the parts of the house where Jonathan and I spent time, enjoying myself, or at least giving the appearance of such, at parties thrown by a publisher, and by various literary festivals. I didn't make well enough of myself as an artist to be recognized by her peers. I failed to take Jonathan away often enough, or long enough that she could have time to write. I indulged Jonathan too much. My rendition of our rupture is, of course, one-sided, perhaps a little flippant, the rewriting of cold facts encouraged by time and distance. I once asked her, "And you and me?" To which her response was a gesture of her hand toward and down the length of my body, a delicate non-verbalization of waning desire. After this, the relationship could not be sustained. It was India who spoke the words first, and a short time later, declaring the obvious was as good as insisting upon it. Over the course of a few months, we became territorial, keeping our belongings, our agendas, our thoughts to ourselves. Then one day, I came home to find Charlie Bream standing in the doorway between the dining room and the kitchen. I couldn't see India, but knew she was in the kitchen. Bream was almost as tall as the height of the doorway. He wore the whitest dress shirt I'd ever seen, long sleeves rolled just below his elbow, and grey wool trousers. He turned and, although I had never met him before, greeted me, as if he and I were old buddies. I sat on the bench in the hallway, taking much longer to remove my shoes than was necessary. Bream's trousers were thick and heavy, and a black leather belt hugged him just below his waist. His black cap-toe Oxfords with their blonde inserts were neatly placed on the shoe mat. They were made in Italy, size 44. One notices everything in such an instant. From where I sat, I could smell Bream's cologne. India, who in the 10 years we had lived together would not boil an egg, was grilling croissants with ham and cheese. I was offered one, but declined and went upstairs to Jonathan's room. There I waited for Bream to leave. I lay on Jonathan's bed and looked down the length of my own body. I had indeed let myself go. I could hear Bream's voice and India's. They spoke evenly, and at a normal volume, which seemed as brazen as if they had been whispering. Charlie Bream didn't last, and he was not, it turned out, one of India's more memorable encounters. But whenever I think of that time, I see in my mind an image of Charlie Bream in the doorway of the kitchen, and his shoes, made in Italy, size 44, on the mat in the entrance. I could not bear to say goodbye to Jonathan, and so I did not. India warned me not to try to fight her for any rights to Jonathan. As an immigrant, as a non-wage-earning person, and most importantly, as a person without her connections, I would, she assured me, lose in every way. Yet for some time I did fight her, not to match her callousness, nor for the principle of the thing, but for the love of the boy I had raised. His needs were the structure around which my days had been built. But that was a time when someone in my position had no legal recourse. India was right, I was outmatched. The irony is that it was Jonathan himself who was at the heart of our tug of war. And soon, I was no longer willing to put him through our struggle. After I left, I discovered that it was not only Jonathan I missed. India used to rub herself after she'd showered with rose oil. Its scent would waft into our bedroom. Even after I had returned to Trinidad, I would be taken hostage by this scent rising up out of nowhere. Sometimes I imagined I saw, in my peripheral vision, piles of folded laundry waiting to be put away. Jonathan's little shirts and trousers, his underwear and t-shirts, India's black V-neck tees, her black skirts, her black underwear, her black jersey dresses, my blue jeans and black t-shirts, and the detergent scent of mountain air would fill my nostrils. I would turn my head quickly to find that I had been tricked by a pile of books, or simply by regret. In the end, these are not the incidents and reflections I want to leave with Jonathan. And perhaps what he wants to know is something else, something more personal too. I suppose I could explain to him that I came to realize that the imagining and dreaming, the wishing and the knowing that led bit by bit to the being I am today, had actually started long before I left Trinidad and went to live in Canada. Long before I met his mother, long before he came into my life. How I have tried in the past to tell him about Zane, that is, but he can't seem to take it in. Now I must explain it to him one more time, how on that particular day in my childhood when I was in the classroom at the new secondary school to which I had transferred, a student I had just met, this Muslim girl named Zane, pinched my arm. How I grabbed her wrist and told her to stop. But it was too late. I'd already felt the strange mix of power and fear that would haunt me forever. Perhaps that was why, upon finishing high school, I left Trinidad and immigrated to Toronto. Granted, I never told him that on one of my visits back to Trinidad, not long after I had parted with India, Zane and I were sitting on the sill of her swimming pool, eating codfish balls and drinking lime juice. She by then an adult married woman and mother of two in a yellow and white two-piece bathing suit. I, the same age, but feeling like some undecided, half-formed thing in my t-shirt and shorts. Both our pairs of feet swinging beneath the surface of the water. And I told her, in a rush, about how one had to undergo psychiatric reviews to transform oneself in the ways I'd just begun to think about, and that only if it were determined that one's mental health was compromised would the insurance pay for what was needed. Zane was quiet for a while. Then as she slid into the water, she said, "That's a shame, because there isn't anything crazy about you." She swam off and dipped under the water. Up came her feet, toes pointed at the sky. She stayed like that for a good minute. I could tell Jonathan how a couple years later, during another visit, Zane pressed into my hand an envelope bulging with American $100 bills that ever since that conversation beside the pool, she had been saving. And sometime after that gesture, I could say I arrived one cold and snowy morning at a building in Toronto, entered a room at an appointed time with a bag full of cash, and changed my life forever. And I could leave it at that. Perhaps these are the stories that would satisfy Jonathan. But they are only a fraction of the truth. and I need to tell him the rest. I need to tell him how I have battled with the belief that had I only been a different person, Zane would be alive today. Had I been a different person. This, more than anything, is what needs to be said. Still, that would be only a fraction of the story. In the end, I hope that Jonathan will understand why, after coming to Canada in search of some sort of authenticity, after living in Toronto for more than 3 decades, I returned home. I returned, that is, to live again in Trinidad. But how do I explain it so that he doesn't think I ran away, gave up, failed? One more chance is all I ask for. But time is against me, and there's so much to tell.
Part 1.
Chapter 1.
It amuses me how the instant the fasten seatbelt sign is turned off during the flight from Toronto to Port of Spain, Trinidadians get up and strut about. They seem to know one another. They congregate in the aisles, unabashedly airing their business, telling jokes, heckling each other, or reminiscing. Their anticipation is palpable. Some begin the journey as strangers, but through conversations struck up in the interminable lineups at the airport or during the 5-hour flight itself, they inevitably learn that they know someone in common or are even related. I've always envied their ease and willing camaraderie, and having been to their island numerous times over the past decade, have often wanted to contribute my penny's worth. But discretion, on account of being just a visitor to the island, has prevailed. On the approach to Trinidad, as the plane comes in from the Caribbean Sea toward the dense blue of the northern range, where there is always the surprise of mountainside villages comprising 3 or 4 houses glimpsed through the clouds, another sign of anticipation occurs. Passengers lower their voices and withdraw into more private preoccupations. Once the mountains are achieved, there is silence on board. The hub of Port of Spain suddenly appears, and I take pleasure in being able to spot the Queen's Park Savannah, the NETT building, and the Laperouse Cemetery before the plane heads out over the sea again, over the Gulf of Paria, where it circles into position to glide into the airport, first over the Carony Swamp, and then over the fertile belly of the Carony Plains. Is it already 2 months since that last flight down? Although I couldn't have imagined then the full extent of what lay in store for me, I sensed that my life was on the verge of another of its ruptures, and I feared that this was, perhaps, to be my final trip here. And so I didn't merely observe the passengers, as had been my habit since my first trip here almost a decade ago, my first trip as an adult, that is. The very first happened some 30 years ago when I was a child. And neither did I merely watch the view from the plane window. This time, I tried to ensnare in my mind every detail of all that went on around me and all that passed outside the window. As we headed over the plains to the airport, I savored the sight of the bamboo-lined, snaking Carony River and, on either side of it, the farmers' houses sitting amidst remnants of cane fields, and the pigeon pea plots and the blackwater rice paddies our reflection sailed across. The usual pleasure of a visit to the island was tainted this time by apprehension, and so, naturally, I recalled the first time I'd come here looking for Sid. After years without a clue as to Sid's whereabouts, internet technology had put at my fingertips the means to realize my dream of finding the parent who had deserted my mother and me when I was 10 years old. Resentment at having been dropped so flatly had plagued me since that time. In junior high school, I'd attempted to register my unhappiness. I'd failed at every subject save for art and English literature and composition, and had embarked on a path of delinquency that included smoking at home and on the school grounds, skipping school, not doing homework, to name the most benign of my transgressions. One might say that I'd no imagination when, in order to escape being at home with my mother, I hid away in the reading booths at the Toronto Reference Library on Yonge Street. But there, in the booths, I lost myself in chronicling my longings and grievances in a notebook. The school psychologist, with whom I was now well acquainted, encouraged me to show him the notebook, and it was with his sustained provocation and encouragement that I began in earnest to turn the facts of my early life into short fictional narratives and poems. For years, well past high school, I managed to keep from my mother any knowledge of this scribbling, or the fact that it had become a passion. I didn't attend university, but found instead a job as a clerk in a health food store on Bloor Street at Spadina. This seemed to both please and unsettle my mother, but still I kept from her what I thought of as my real work. When I eventually signed a contract for my first book with her publisher, it was without her knowledge. I'll never be sure that the publisher was not simply doing her a favor when he took me on. Perhaps, too, he might have thought that investing in the work of the son of one of his most successful authors made good business sense. My mother received news of that first book's release with undisguised consternation. She read the novel in one sitting. I waited for her response, ostrich-like, hoping that she would ignore the autobiographical nature of the work and see only the craft. The instant I glimpsed her face, I knew that there would be little conversation about the book. I was right. "Oh, Choji, get over it, will you? Please," was all she said. Nevertheless, over the course of some years, two more books followed. On reading the second, India said, "You're not at all a bad writer, but you're repeating yourself." I can't deny that with each book's publication, I hoped that hype about them would attract Sid's attention. If Sid were to read any of my works, my thoughts went, she would surely find in them reflections of our past life together and my present longing, and would contact me, and our reconciliation would happen. But no such thing occurred. And to make matters more unbearable, my books weren't much of a success. Nevertheless, my publisher, my mother's publisher, I remind myself, maintained an interest in me. Pressed to present a new manuscript for his consideration, I tried for years, in vain, to come up with stories and themes that veered away from my personal experiences. When I realized I couldn't write anymore, or so it appeared, I sank into a long depression, during which there were periods when I pointed squarely at Sid's cold-hearted departure for what I saw as my failures. I took to hiding out again at the reference library, my laptop unused now for word processing, the gateway out of my morass. And it was in this way that my depression and bitterness were reshaped, at the computer, into the hope of reconciliation, if not between Sid and my mother, then at least between Sid and me. And my search became an obsession. I imagined daily what it would be like if and when Sid and I were reacquainted. The reality was not quite so swift or easy. Over the course of several years, I typed the name Sid Mahaley into the Google search box and found that while there were quite a few Sid Mahaleys in the world, none jumped out as immediate possibilities. Images that appeared beside that name were interesting, but useless. A book that didn't have any clear relationship to the name. Photos of parklands, flowers, dogs. There was one image of a pyramid-shaped bottle of perfume, one of a pile of burning car tires, and a few of the banks of the River Ganges. I managed to find email addresses for every Sid Mahaley, whose profile glancingly resembled that of my Sid's, and over time I wrote letters of inquiry to them all and kept my fingers crossed. To my surprise, all my letters received responses, but invariably they ended with the hope that I would soon find their namesake. My Sid Mahale was Trinidadian, had immigrated to Toronto more than 40 years ago, and was a visual artist, a painter. I eventually found an announcement on the internet for an exhibition of paintings by a Sid Mahale at a gallery in Queens in New York, and bought a plane ticket there. As I recall this now, I'm impressed by my own recklessness and the utter hope contained in that impulsive gesture. On the night of the opening, I arrived at the so-called gallery, a narrow and claustrophobic living room, to find that this Sid Mahale was a thin young woman in her second year at art school. Her family was Ugandan, and she knew no Trinidadians with the same surname. I bought one of her smaller paintings for $175. At the time, I had no idea if my Sid had remained in Toronto, was still working as an artist, had gone elsewhere in Canada or to some other part of the world, or had returned to Trinidad. For some reason, Trinidad was the last place I looked. It only occurred to me to do so when I didn't find her in Toronto, in New York, or elsewhere. I certainly didn't rush here. Hindsight suggests that in spite of my obsession with my search, I must have chosen to spin my wheels. Perhaps I knew in the depths of my being that it would be difficult, and possibly more painful than it was worth, to reconnect with a parent who had left me without word and had never made any attempt to be in touch. And so, after a while, the search degenerated into the idea of the search, and for a time, it was my romance. Sometimes there are elaborate calculations that lead to action, and sometimes there is no cognition, just action impetuously taken. For me, it was as simple as awakening one morning 9 years ago and knowing instantly that I would go to Trinidad. There's no point in attempting to find a deeper understanding. I was simply and truly ready. 30 years or so ago, my mother, Sid, and I had visited Sid's parents' house in Trinidad. That was the true first visit to the island for me, and it had taken place 1 year before the dreadful split-up. On the morning 9 years ago, when I bolted awake with my new resolve, I remembered that the Mahale house was in a small town called San Fernando. In the Google search box, I typed, Sid Mahale, San Fernando, Trinidad, and a message came up asking if I meant Sydney Mahale, San Fernando, Trinidad. I decided to try again. Sid's father was a doctor, but I didn't remember his first name, so I typed in Dr. Mahale, followed by San Fernando and Trinidad, and up popped an obituary from a newspaper. And there in the obituary, I found Sid's full name, Sidani. My heart pounded in excitement. I wrote, Sidani Mahale, San Fernando, Trinidad. And a message came up asking again, Did you mean Sydney Mahale, San Fernando, Trinidad? On the link for Sydney Mahale, San Fernando, Trinidad, there was no image to search under. But knowing that Trinidad is a small country, and remembering the joking between Sid and my mother that all Trinidadians were related or knew each other, I thought that this Sydney might know of my Sid. It crossed my mind that I might discover this Sydney Mahale was, like myself, one of Sid's sons. If so, he might be, I supposed, a real son. The real son. This caused some jealousy, I'll admit. But he'd be a brother of sorts, too, I reasoned. I'd liked the island as a child, and I was already consumed by the idea of a trip. Perhaps I would be lucky. But if not, the trip wouldn't be wasted. I'd always felt an affinity for the place, and I could spend a week in Trinidad doing a bit of writing, hiking in the northern range, and looking for the places I'd visited during that long-ago childhood trip, and perhaps I could attach to this another week in Tobago, snorkeling. The telephone book in my San Fernando hotel room was not an inch thick, and included residential and business numbers. It couldn't have been easier. While there was no Sid Mahaley, I did find Sidney Mahaley. I picked up the receiver several times to make the phone call, but decided instead to take a taxi to the address in the phone book. Sidney Mahaley's house was not, as I'd expected, in the south of the island, but in the northwest. A man I would later come to know as Lancelot met me at the gate and asked whom he might tell Mr. Sidney was there to see him. I gave him my name, Jonathan Lewis-Adey, but added that Mr. Mahaley might very well not know of me. I waited for what seemed like an eternity before the same man, Lancelot, returned and unlocked the gate's three padlocks. He pulled open the gate and invited me in. Halfway up the yard, an older gentleman with an unsteady gait approached. It dawned on me that this was Sidney Mahaley, and I realized at once that a person of this age couldn't be a child of Sid. He and my Sid were very likely of the same age. The gentleman and I looked at each other, and I made the gesture of offering my hand in greeting. But before I could understand what was happening, my heart heaved. The eyes. I knew them. The smile. It wasn't a resemblance. The smile was the same. I was overcome by a dreadful panic. I could hardly breathe. Sidney Mahaley didn't shake my extended hand, but pulled me to him. I went like a child, and although I was a great deal taller than I'd been when I was 10, I pressed my head to the shoulder of this person, once a mother to me, and I cried like a child. That was 9 years ago. On finding Sidney Mahaley, I'd encountered not the parent who'd from the first day of my life loved and understood me better than anyone else, including my mother, but a stranger who confounded and challenged me. Still, I came every year from then on to be with him, sometimes more than once a year. I would often stare at Sidney, baffled that inside this unfamiliar being resided the fullest picture, the fullest comprehension of who I'd been as a child. Sidney's voice, like that of a pubescent boy, incongruent in a person of his age. The angularity of his body, the thinned hair and receded hairline, the coarseness of a face whose skin I remembered from my childhood as being silky. There was stubble on it now from the shaving. And the pungency of his skin were a wall between the person I remembered and once adored and the relationship I'd expected to reignite. It took time, desire, and patience on both our parts before I could see that while the material, the physical form of the past as I'd known it, had changed utterly, the heart of it was steady and true. 9 years later, all has changed. It was reasonable on this current visit to expect that there would be no beach limes, no crab hunting on the east coast, no scotch drinking in the thick and foamy surf late into the salty night, no evenings skimming the obsidian waters of the swamp, scarlet ibis drifting inkily across the slanted sky. As it turned out, lowering my expectations that this would be a visit without the glow of a vacation was the least that would be demanded of me. Outside the airport's terminal building, the humidity, the heat, the incessant percussive and tinny steel drum music that welcomed visitors, the crowd of passengers and their waiting families and friends were suffocating. How I wished that time could be reversed, that this was my first trip looking for Sid. Thankfully, I didn't have to wait long for Sidney's chauffeur, Shankar. Out of the chaos he slid, taking the bag from my hand, ushering me through the drizzle toward the car. I knew the drive past the capital city to the northwestern arm of the island well, and was prepared for the near hour's journey to the house in Scenery Hills. It would no doubt be riddled with drivers, abundant infractions and death-inviting maneuvers, traffic jams, and, fringing the entire route to the house, dangerously situated vendors' stands that offered everything from bundles of barely alive blue crabs to battery-run fly and mosquito swatters, to cell phone cases, to papayas and avocados the size of soccer balls. I was, by this time, no longer discombobulated by the constant chaos on the streets or the unfamiliar attitudes to time and to laws, by the unexpected politeness and solicitations, the heat and the bugs, or the sugary, oily, and fiery foods. I had, after all, traveled here close to 20 times in almost a decade. By the time Shankar reached the residential area of Scenery Hills, the rain had eased and the sun come out. Shankar gestured to the tropical phenomenon of falling rain and brilliant sun, different in quality of light and even texture of the rain itself from the sun showers we in Canada know. And he said, as if it were a question, "The devil and his wife?" I felt like a child, but I knew it would please him if I finished his sentence. "Are quarreling," I said. We were both pleased that I'd remembered the local saying. Sydney was usually wheeled out into the garden by Lancelot at 4:30 or so every afternoon, but this time he'd waited for me to take him out. In the past, he would almost lift himself out of the chair, reaching his arms up around my neck in greeting. But today he remained sitting, his hands on his lap, turning them palms up for me to rest mine inside. He had indeed deteriorated. I pushed the chair through the wet grass to the edge of the garden and positioned it to face the calming waters of the Gulf, grateful that Lancelot had telephoned me in Toronto to say that I should come down at once. I'd been skeptical at first, given that I'd rushed to Sydney's side on two previous occasions because
"Sydney take in bad, and only call in your name," as Lancelot had explained. "If he come true, it only because God so good he spare him, yes. And therefore I should come quick. So down I rushed. Of course, Sydney had pulled through both times. After the last trip, I'd returned home to Toronto thinking irritably of Lancelot as the nursemaid who cried wolf. But when he'd telephoned this last time, something compelled me to drop everything and head to the airport. Perhaps it was Lancelot's unusual restraint and his use of standard English.
"Mr. Sydney isn't doing too well," he said.
"He's weak."
"We are a little worried. If you don't mind us saying so, Mr. Jonathan, we think you should come. If he sees you, he might pick up."
The red and black plaid wool blanket I'd foolishly brought Sydney the first time I visited was draped on his lap, as if the air were as chilly as a late fall Toronto evening. I'm still embarrassed and amused by my own prior ignorance. Knowing more now, I think of stories I've heard about aid agencies battling the after-effects of disasters in tropical countries, appealing to well-meaning people from colder climes, like my old self, I suppose, not to make donations of duvets, wool blankets, fur coats, and the like. But Sydney used the blanket right up until the end. I don't know if it was because it suited his actual needs or because it was I who gave it to him. That evening, Sydney didn't hold my hand like he usually did. He wasn't able to. His remained in mine only because I gripped it firmly. His skin was cool. It had become thin. I tried, and I certainly hope I succeeded, not to show my utter terror at how he had weakened and aged since I was last here. The thick gold bangle I've always known him to wear, a beira, it's called here, seemed too large and far too heavy for his slender wrist.
The sea ahead shimmered gold and onyx, and the sky, shot across only minutes before with wispy tails of gold-dappled airplane exhaust, soon turned bloody brown. We sat watching the light play on the sea, both of us quiet. Everything seemed at once dire and ultimately of no consequence. What words dare be spoken, sentiments expressed in such circumstances? Save for the screeching of parrots as they lumbered like stones through the air, the rustling of billowy stands of bamboo in the hills behind us, and the passage of the occasional car below, it was a quiet evening. Time seemed to collapse, and once again I found myself acutely aware of my surroundings. I stored in my memory details of the view, of the scents and sounds, and at the same time my mind leaped forward in place and time, imagining looking back on the moment we were in. Then, quite contrarily, I thought of Toronto, of how cold it had been when I left that morning, so cold that I wore my leather jacket to the airport, and I left it in Catherine's hands as we said goodbye on the sidewalk outside of Terminal 3. Such cold there, I thought, and here, such suffocating humidity. The extremes available to a person in a single day. Poor Catherine, I thought, too, and immediately wondered if it was fair to pity her and yet hold on to her. She'd come to know that whenever I visited Sydney, I was leaving her in more ways than one. And then I realized that in thinking of Catherine, I'd squandered precious moments with Sydney. I focused my mind and squeezed his hand. He cleared his throat. I found myself saying lightly that his skin was a bit dry, and that next time I came down I would bring him a good hand cream. He nodded. Ahead of us, the iron bulk of oil tankers, faded rust orange, rode high and leaned back as they awaited cargo from the oil refinery to the south. From the refinery's harbor, an iron and asphalt archipelago in the Gulf, danced tiny points of orange flame that intensified as darkness descended. Lights on the lower decks of the cruise ships had lit up as we sat. The staccato sound of a police siren floated upward on a breeze, followed by the monotonous two-tone siren of an ambulance. Sydney pulled lightly at my hand. I stooped at his side. In a low voice, he asked how I was getting along with my work. I told him that I'd written a few small pieces for magazines. He asked more directly, had I been able to make headway with the writing of short stories or a novel? He must have known that I wasn't telling the truth when I said, "Yes, yes, I'm working on something," and elaborated no more. He merely nodded again. Then he advised me that he had spoken with the pundit who would officiate at the end. I chastised him, gently, of course, saying that there was no need for such thinking, no need for such talk, and that once we were back inside the house, we should telephone his doctor and request a house call, and that I was sure that he'd in no time feel better. He let me ramble, but when I finished, he was firm. Whether we liked it or not, he said, the conversation had to happen. And what would make him feel better right then was to know that he had said what needed to be said, and that I'd heard him. I felt suddenly weak, and my tongue seemed to swell inside my mouth, stifling my words. The chugging of fishermen's boats grew louder, and the voices drifted our way. In my mind waxed an image of the market at the wharf in Port of Spain, a vendor's stall there, and on the counter deep trays of shaved ice that cradled plastic bags of fishtails, bones, and heads. Eyes blank and lips parted to reveal rows of tiny teeth and hard, fat tongues. Sydney said something, but his voice seemed far away, as in my mind I levitated. Like a dragonfly, I darted off, and in an instant was high above the King's Wharf in Port of Spain,
looking down at the fish market, at beached pirogues, a cruise ship, and the St. Vincent Jetty lighthouse, and the traffic circling it. I took off inland, around the humming towers and the wires of the city's electricity plant, and over the cemetery, and only when I arrived at the savannah, above a bromeliad-laden, centuries-old saman tree, did I come to a halt, truly in midair. I angled myself to make a nosedive into a coconut vendor's stand. Sydney must have seen that I'd gone far away, for in his typical manner he sharply, yet gently, squeezed and shook my hand to bring me back to attention. "Listen, Jonathan," he said. "You must listen, please." He wanted me to take the lead in the ceremony, he said. I bore up quickly and had enough presence of mind to speak around the thickness in my mouth, the lightness in my head. "What would taking the lead entail?" I asked. He brushed the question away with a gesture of his fingers and said that Pundit would guide me through everything. My dread must have been evident, for Sydney said that I shouldn't worry too much, that it was all quite straightforward. I was to take charge of his affairs, too, he said. He'd left notes outlining it all. He said he wanted me to know that the house, this house here in Scenery Hills, would be mine. This last was too much at once, too premature. I may have arrived expecting the worst, but now that I was here, in his presence, touching him and speaking with him, I wasn't prepared to let him go so soon. Sydney then asked if I would wear the beira that was on his wrist. I held both his hands in mine and brought them to my lips. When I was a child, such displays of affection had been the norm between us, but over these last years, we'd not been physically close. During Sydney's final days, however, nothing was as usual. If a script exists for such a time, I've never seen it, and all that I'd learned about how to conduct myself in the world fell away and had to be reinvented. Time and habits and ways shifted forward and backward and sideways without reason. Sydney slid the beira off his wrist and tried to put it on mine without success. I put it back on his wrist, and our mutual distress was relieved with more laughter than the situation merited. We moved inside the house as the last light faded. Sydney insisted he didn't want the doctor. He wanted time alone with me, he said. His frailness in the lamplight appalled me, and, looking back, I've asked myself, how could I not have seen that he was so close to the end? Still, I console myself with the thought that nothing about him indicated that he was anything but compos mentis, and perhaps I erred on the side of respect for his autonomy. Perhaps I should simply have heeded my own judgment and called for a doctor the instant I'd arrived at the house. But there were things on his mind, things he'd begun to tell me and hadn't finished, and he insisted he needed to tell me everything now. For who knew if there was to be another visit?
Chapter 2.
During my many previous visits to his home in Scenery Hills, Sydney would regale me with stories. He'd once said, and I'm not entirely sure if he was joking, that if I ever ran out of stories to tell, the ones he was telling me would surely serve me well. Perhaps, I thought, but only if he told me what I wanted to hear. If he wasn't telling me tales about his high school friend Zane, who had never left Trinidad, then he would tell and retell the story of a walk he took one early and snowy morning from his apartment in Toronto's East End to a clinic in the downtown core. Over the years, I'd come to anticipate those moments when Sydney would squint at the mercurial sky and fix his questioning gaze on some site where was written, it seemed, these seemingly unrelated anecdotes. Sometimes, as one recounting went on, it would contradict previous ones. He would pluck out of the tome in the sky some memory of Zane or of that walk, the blizzard the night before, or the street worker who had tried to get his attention, or the overturned, snow-covered wheelchair in the neighbor's yard, and resume whichever version he fancied. He had an astonishing capacity for recall and for detail, and in his penchant for digression, he would often follow to great depth seemingly tangential threads that would be suddenly dropped, left hanging loose and frayed. I would always listen with half an ear cocked for reflections on our family, longing to hear mention of me, some indication that in all the years after he'd gone away, I'd remained in his thoughts. And I can't deny that this last time I was again hopeful that what Sidney hadn't finished saying, and now needed so desperately to say, concerned his relationship with me. I expected, too, that he'd tell me immediately what was on his mind, but instead he asked me to take him into the dining room, as it was dinner time, and he'd asked Rosita to welcome me back with her stewed pork and red beans. Although he himself had no appetite and wouldn't eat, he sat at the table with me. I was too worried about his condition to appreciate the meal. I had the good sense, however, to make some noise about how good it was, how touched I was that it had been made for me. I kept hoping that he'd begin to tell me whatever it was that was so urgent, but perhaps Rosita hovering in the doorway between the kitchen and dining room, a sign of her anxiety about his health, inhibited him. I helped him into his bed shortly after, worried that perhaps the right time had passed, or perhaps it simply hadn't come at all and never would. But at just that moment, thankfully, he asked me to sit on the edge of the bed and stay with him a while. He began, to my immense disappointment, by saying,
"Jonathan, you know that morning I told you about when I walked in the snowstorm to the Irene Samuel Health and Gender Center in Toronto? My heart that day was so heavy. There was no one with me, you know. There was all this snow and ice on the road, and as I've told you, there was that dreadful, dreadful wind. But I insisted on walking there. There were cabs about, but I wouldn't hail any of them."
He laughed then and said,
"I didn't even want the company of a taxi driver."
My heart sank. Sidney was repeating, yet again, the story of that walk. Surely, I thought, he didn't have the energy to embark on such a story, and I worried that precious moments were passing. I interrupted him, doing my best to reassure him that while I was always keen to hear that particular story, perhaps he ought to first tell me whatever was most pressing. He sighed and said,
"Listen, Jonathan, this is what I want to tell you about. I have never told you how that walk ended, but this time I must tell you. I must tell you all of it."
In my head, trapped there, thankfully, growled a rather loud voice, "All right, then tell me again if you must, but for the love of God, please also tell me why you left our family." Sidney and I stared at each other. Then, as if he knew my mind, he said,
"Perhaps, Jonathan, you've been looking for simple explanations, but there is hardly ever a single answer to anything. And isn't it so that the stories one most needs to know are the ones that are usually the least simple or straightforward?"
Sidney spoke in a soft voice, calculating his words.
"Contradictions are inevitable," he continued. "You listening to my story is yet another angle. My story is incomplete, you see, Jonathan, without your interpretation, over which I have little control. No matter my noblest intentions, and no matter how detailed my accounts, you may still only catch a fraction of what I say. You must trust that in the story I will tell you tonight, God willing, is contained all you've wanted to know."
The writer in me understood in a flash. I was silent then, and I listened. And Sydney spoke slowly, yet evenly, into the early hours of the morning. He insisted on beginning with the winter walk, and carried on as if there'd been no interruption, and as if it had been an account he had rehearsed. "As I was saying," he said, "there were cabs coming and going, but I did not avail myself of them. There I was, in the cold, wet whiteness of that snowy morning, struggling against everything. As I walked along Shooter Street, I would have liked to hear a monkey howl. That morning I would have liked to hear the chug of a pirogue, a steel pan being played, cricket commentary coming from another immigrant's transistor radio balanced on his or her shoulder. As I trudged on the ice in Regent Park that morning, I imagined the blue stillness of the Tucker Valley in the Shagarama's foothills. I was transported for a moment, thinking I heard Kiskadees calling out to one another. And this is how it has always been. Over there, I thought constantly of here. But now, look, I'm lying here in this heat, in this house, the tepid, salty gulf just yards away from us, sick as a dog. And of what do I speak? Of walking in the snow one dark, frigid morning, a quarter century ago. But how it pleases me to do so. I am recalling the rumble of a faraway city, the frenetic howls of ambulances and police cars, of fire trucks roaring down the Don Valley Parkway, and heard even in winter, when the windows and the balcony door in my third-floor studio apartment on Bergamot Avenue were sealed against cold and wind and wet. In the tropical comfort of a bedroom in Scenery Hills, with the whistles of frogs and cicadas in the background, the sound of boats chugging through the night, how clearly I hear the sizzle and hum that came from the light of the street lamp outside the building on Bergamot Avenue. I can see in the light's yellowish-pink shaft exotic downy feathers of snow. Then, to my surprise, Sydney began to speak of his friend Zane. If I could have asked someone to accompany me to the Irene Samuel, it would have been Zane, he said. But of course that was impossible. So I did the next best thing, and in the knapsack I wore that day, I placed all the letters she had ever written to me. It was as if she were with me. My mind, confounded by this turn in his tale, drifted as he spoke, and I recalled the first time Sydney had told me of his friend years ago. The sounds of the sea were a constant backdrop whenever Sydney and I were in the garden or here inside the house, and my recollections of first learning of Zane were full of those kinds of sounds. A car gearing up or wheezing on the brake as it went down the hilly road. A lone steel drum tinkling in practice somewhere nearby, a dog, or a chorus of them barking. But that day, I didn't hear Lancelot and Rosita's chatter and bickering coming from inside the house, and I noticed their absence. It was mid-morning, perhaps the third or fourth visit I'd made to Trinidad. I knocked on Sydney's bedroom door. There was no answer, so I knocked again, and then opened the door just a crack to make sure he was all right. The windows were wide open, the end of the tied-back curtains whipping up in the breeze. Coming from the other side of the street was the erratic whir of a weed trimmer. A cool, pleasant light washed the sparse room. Sydney was lying on top of the made-up double bed in red boxer shorts and a teal tank top that hugged his heavy torso, which starkly contrasted with his frail legs. He was reading a letter. I called to him, and finally he acknowledged my presence.
He gestured me into the room and folded the letter. A green knapsack lay off to the side. Scattered around Sydney were several greeting cards, letters on formal writing paper, an uneven stack of torn bits of paper held together by a paperclip. He'd been shaved, and his skin was a light, powdery gray. He hadn't had his mid-morning nap, it seemed. I asked how he was feeling, to which he replied, with a tone of futility, that he was as good as could be expected. I asked if he'd taken his medications, to which he merely nodded. I glanced at the correspondence, feeling awkward about my intrusion. "Letters from a friend," he said, as if I'd asked. He gathered the scraps. "These are the first ones she wrote me," he said. I was a grown man, but transparent as a child to Sydney. He'd spotted the flicker of curiosity in me and commented, "No, no. It's not like that, Jonathan. There was never a romance between my friend, Zane is her name, and me. Zane and I were, however, the very best, the closest of friends." I felt these words with a prickle of jealousy as acute as if I, and not my mother, had been his lover. Seconds later, he elaborated in a fashion that unsettled me again, as if I were a pebble caught in the push and pull of small, quarrelsome waves at the water's edge. "In a way," Sydney said, "it was better than a romance." The letters, now part of his legacy to me, were written with a fountain pen, in ink that had turned the purplish brown. None were dated.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.